Yo, yo, what up with it, everyone? It's Sean, hope you're well. Don't forget to share this if you want to win some shit, win a shirt. People waiting on some stickers, getting some new stickers printed up at the moment, sorry, then I'll send some out. So busy, special episodes and shit coming out, got some hectic interviews in the works. I think that's it. Check out the sources, I always put them at the end of the episode so you can see where the music comes from and where you can get further reading and whatnot. And yeah, share this, win some shit, love yous all. I'm tired, bye bye.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
You're listening to Carousel Sniper Victim, a Dead Glass Design production, with your host, Sean Jeffrey.
A source of real concern. Well, the immediate reaction was disbelief. This sort of thing can't have happened in Mosman. It must be somebody from outside. Got to be. One of us wouldn't
tell us anything about the actual attack or anything that had happened to her or how she'd actually ended up in hospital. And I picked up a mirror and I said, look, Doris, somebody did this to you, and showed a reflection in the mirror. And her reply was, that's not me. So it was one of extreme disappointment. And basically, walked out of the hospital wondering what else can go wrong.
We appealed to the public after this attempted murder in October. What we did get out of this, which became part of our investigation, was that some witnesses sighted a skateboard rider, a young male in late teens, who was riding a skateboard down on the footpath outside this retirement village round about the time of the murder. So these witnesses supplied a sketch drawing, a penry was done, and it was released to the media. And for several weeks, we endeavoured to find the skateboard rider.
Serial killers the likes of John Wayne Glover are extremely rare. In most cases of serial murder, the perpetrators very rarely leave what's known as a calling card. A repetitive clue or injury telling investigators that this is the work of the same killer. A perfect example was John Wayne Glover. Each time that Glover committed serial murder, he ruthlessly bashed his victims to death with a hammer in public places in broad daylight, and then strangled the last breath out of them with their own underwear. The killings were unmistakably the work of one person. John Glover was the granny killer, or the Monster of Mosman. A vicious and calculating serial killer who deep etched a macabre niche for himself into the history of Australia's most reprehensible murderers. Glover was the only serial killer who specialised in bashing and murdering little old grannies. However horrible and despicable a character he turned out to be, John Wayne Glover was the least likely person you would suspect to be a serial killer. He was as inconspicuous as he was pure evil. A big friendly man in his late 50s, he was the backbone of middle class society and the type of guy you could leave in charge of your kids or ask to keep an eye on your house while you were away. Married with two daughters, Glover and his loved ones lived a contented lifestyle in their comfortable family home in the fashionable harbourside Sydney suburb of Mosman. But it was mainly in these tranquil surroundings that he would bash and kill his victims. To add to his image of the regular middle-aged man, Glover held down a job as a sales representative with none other than the famous 4 and 20 Pie Company. His warm handshake and jolly smile endeared new acquaintances to him immediately. He was basically a walking advertisement for his product that he sold. The type of bloke that it was just nice to be around. However, John Glover was chronically addicted to poker machines. He would stand for hours virtually pouring money through the slot machines at the Mosman RSL Club. The easiest way for Glover to get more money was just to steal it. As police would reveal later, Glover was a convicted thief and had a record of cowardly attacks on defenseless women. When it all really kicked off though, or as Glover would refer to it later, the start of it all, came on the 11th of January, 1989. Glover saw 84-year-old Mrs. Margaret Todhunter walking along Quiet Hale Road in Mosman. He parked his car and, after he was satisfied that no one was looking, he punched the unsuspecting woman in the face with a swinging right hook and stole her handbag containing $209. As he fled down the street with her handbag, Mrs. Todhunter called out, quote, "You rotten bugger," end quote. Glover went to the Mosman RSL where he drank and played the poker machines with the stolen money. Investigating police put the incident down to just a random mugging and suspected that someone saw the elderly woman with the cash and waited for the right moment. In the drug-ravaged suburbs of Sydney, muggings are a daily occurrence, and while the case was investigated thoroughly, little hope was given to recovering the money or finding the perpetrators of such a cowardly act. Mrs. Todhunter did survive the ordeal, but she was badly bruised and shaken. And as it eventuated, she was also extremely lucky. Glover's next victim was not so fortunate. On the 1st of March 1989, Glover had had a few drinks at the Mosman RSL after work and mid-afternoon was heading for his car down busy Military Road when he spotted Gwendolyn Mitchell Hill. She was going home from the shops at a slow pace with her walking stick. Glover hurriedly returned to his car and tucked a hammer into his belt. Then he slowly followed the old woman to the seclusion of the entry foyer of her retirement village. As she turned the key in the lock, Glover brought the hammer down with a crashing blow to the back of her skull. He then repeatedly bashed her so viciously about the head and body that he broke several ribs in her tiny, jockey weight frame. He fled the scene, taking her wallet containing $100. Incredibly, Mrs. Mitchell Hill was still alive when two schoolboys found her, but she would become the granny killer's first official murder victim, just a few minutes after the police and ambulance arrived. The police had no eyewitnesses or leads, and nothing concrete linked this attack with the previous attack on Margaret Todhunter. No forensic evidence was available either, as good-intentioned neighbours, believing that she had merely fallen, washed the crime scene clean. The police assumed that it must be another mugging gone horribly wrong. As Mrs. Mitchell Hill drew her last breath, though, Glover himself was sitting in his lounge room at home, wondering out loud to his wife what all the sirens in the distance must be about. Again, the police were baffled. But there was nothing concrete to link the two attacks. There was a theory that they could be the work of the one person, but at the time it was a long shot. Police finally assumed that it was yet another mugging and that everything was just gone disastrously wrong. And then, 10 weeks later, in the late afternoon of May 9th, Glover was heading for the Mosman RSL Club in Military Road when he saw Lady Winifred Ashton walking slowly towards him in a red raincoat and also with the aid of a walking stick. Lady Ashton had been playing bingo at the RSL and was heading toward her home in nearby Raglan Street. Glover pulled on a pair of gloves and followed her into the foyer of her apartment building, where he attacked her with his hammer and threw her to the ground in the rubbish bin alcove. Now, although suffering from lymphatic cancer, the tiny and frail Lady Ashton put up a fucking incredible struggle, and Glover actually later confessed that, quote, at one stage, she almost had me, until I fell on top of her and repeatedly bashed her head against the concrete, end quote. Lady Winifred Ashton was 84 years old. Lady Ashton was unconscious as John Glover removed her pantyhose and strangled her with them. Although no sexual act took place, this gruesome ritual would become Glover's calling card. And then, as if in respect or something for the dead woman, Glover laid her walking stick and shoes at her feet before he headed off with her purse, which contained $100. Glover would later comment to the bar staff at the Mosman RSL that he hoped that those sirens they could hear just around the corner weren't for another mugging. He said this as he calmly fed the contents of Lady Ashton's purse through the poker machines. Only now did police believe that they had a maniacal killer on the loose. There were just starting to be too many similarities. To date, all of the three victims were wealthy old ladies. All came from the same suburb and all were assaulted or killed in a similar manner. And all were robbed of their handbags. This wasn't the work of just some ordinary mugger. Although it was now a strong possibility, the thought of one individual seeking out and murdering defenseless old women was just almost beyond comprehension. At the time, police prayed that they were wrong, but secretly they knew the truth. But John Glover was just getting started. He leaned even deeper into his depraved behaviour and in a bizarre twist of events, he started molesting old women confined to their beds in the nursing homes he visited in the course of his rounds as a pie salesman. This was an aspect of the case that detectives and psychiatrists would just later find confusing. It didn't seem to mesh with the violent criminal behaviour that he was so far displaying. Glover maintained that he had no sexual interest in anyone. He never sexually attacked any of his robbery and murder victims, yet there he was, prowling around nursing homes and assaulting bedridden old women. Local police investigated, but the alarm bells just didn't ring. The molestations were not connected to the murders at the time, and though at a later date the incidents would play an important part in identifying Glover, at the time they still just slipped by unnoticed. On his nursing home rounds, Glover first molested 77-year-old Mrs. Marjorie Mosley on June 6, 1989, at the Wesley Gardens retirement home in Belrose, which is quite a distance from Mosman. Mrs. Mosley did report the incident and said that the man put his hands under her nightie, but she couldn't really recall what he looked like. Then, on June the 24th, Glover visited the Caroline Chisholm nursing home in nearby Lane Cote. He leisurely strolled upstairs, where he lifted the dress of an elderly woman and fondled her bottom. Moving to the room next door, he slid his hand down the front of another woman's nightdress and stroked her breasts. The terrified woman cried out, and Glover was questioned briefly by the staff, but he wasn't held as he made a hurried exit. The incidents were investigated by the local police again, but were not connected to the murders in Mosman. And it was a long time before it was thought that this information may be of any use to the Granny Killer Task Force, which had by now been established. By the time the connection was made, there had been more attacks, more bashings, and more murders. On August the 8th, 1989, Glover bashed elderly Effie Carney in a quiet street in Linfield, not far from Mosman, and he stole her groceries. On October 6, he passed himself off as a doctor and ran his hand up the dress of one Phyllis McNeil, a patient at the Wibinia nursing home at Neutral Bay. Again, he avoided capture when the blind old woman called for help. It seemed that Glover could walk in and out of hospitals as easy as he pleased. No one suspected the happy little pastry salesman. On the 18th of October, Glover struck again. And this time he struck with a ferocity that would convince police that their worst nightmare was in fact a reality. That the attacks were the work of one man. But in what would later prove to be a cruel irony, the assault would actually start them looking for the wrong type of offender. In the mid-afternoon of October 18th, Glover struck up a conversation with 86-year-old Mrs. Doris Cox as she slowly made her way home along Spit Road in Mosman. He walked with her into the secluded stairwell of her retirement village, and then he attacked her from behind, using his entire body weight to smash her face into a brick wall. She collapsed at his feet. After finding nothing that he wanted in her handbag, Glover left her for dead and went home. Mrs. Cox was suffering from Alzheimer's. She somehow survived the attack, but she was hazy about the description of her attacker, even though she saw him while they walked together. In her understandably confused state, she thought that her attacker was a younger man and assisted the police as best that she could in preparing an identikit drawing. At last, the police believed they had a lead. To the head of the task force, Detective Inspector Mike Hagen, the new information made sense. He had always suspected that the killer was a local because of the close proximity of the killings and muggings. As well, police psychological profiles suggested the killer would most likely be a teenager with a grandmother fixation, and Mrs. Cox now thought that she had been bashed by a young man. Mike Hagen now concentrated the task force energies in search of a young local who may be acting strangely or had any possible relationship or connection to the victims. Tragically, this theory was only right to the extent it suggested the killer was a local. It would almost appear that some unknown force was protecting Glover, as his next attack would lead police to doubt that the man they sought was even actually a local. The murder of 85-year-old Mrs. Margaret Parhood on November the 2nd was undoubtedly the work of the granny killer. She was bashed on the back of the head by a blunt instrument as she made her way home along a laneway off busy Longview Road, Lane Cove. Coronial evidence presented at the trial indicated that the attack was over in seconds, and from the force of the blows taken by her massively fractured skull, the coroner concluded that it was doubtful the poor old woman felt a thing. Glover took her handbag and tucked it inside his shirt with the hammer and calmly left the scene. There were no known witnesses, although Mrs. Parhood's body was found within minutes by a passing schoolgirl who at first thought that it was just a bundle of clothing dumped in the laneway. And then, to make matters worse yet again, neighbours washed down the crime scene. As the police and ambulance sirens wailed their way to the murder scene, Glover examined the contents of Mrs. Parhood's purse on the grounds of a nearby golf club where he pocketed $300 and hid her bag in a drain. He then went on to the Mosman RSL club where he drank and gambled with Margaret's money. By now, police were almost frantic with frustration. This murder was committed about 5 kilometres from Mosman, and their theory about it being a local was now losing credibility. Now they decided they were looking for a teenager who came from just about anywhere. Baffled and no closer to solving the case than they were when it had all started 10 months earlier, the police intensified their investigations. And then, 2 murders in 1 day. Reinforcements were called in, and Australia's biggest task force to date to search for one man was formed. 35 of the state's most experienced detectives gathered at police headquarters and were told by Task Force Chief Hagen that they must work day and night and investigate every possible lead, however minute, until the killer was caught. A $20,000 reward was posted by the New South Wales government. Composite pictures of the suspect were left in shops, service stations, and newsagents. Meanwhile, Hagen was becoming a nervous wreck and later said, quote, "I've had nearly 30 years on the job, and I think the worst month of my police experience was November 1989. You get so frustrated with yourself and those around you when you can't get a result, and it's just very stressful. You'd go home and you're on edge all night. I wasn't eating or sleeping, and this cowardly killer just kept murdering frail old ladies." End quote. Hagen spent most of the day after Mrs. Parhood's death at the murder scene, yet as the hours passed, he had to face the grim reality that the killer had eluded them yet again without leaving so much as a trace of evidence. Exhausted from the lack of sleep by the end of the day, Hagen called in to Pennant Hills Police Station on his way home to answer an urgent message on his beeper. This is back in the late 80s, there's no mobile phones, remember. He dialed Task Force headquarters and his knees sagged as he was told that they had another body. Another pantyhose strangled old woman. He later said, quote, "I just can't explain my feelings that night. To have come from a murder and to be told there's another one, it was terrible. We had 2 serial murders within 24 hours. We'd never heard of such a thing before." End quote. The granny killer's 4th victim was 81-year-old Miss Olive Cleveland, a resident of the Wesley Gardens retirement village at Belrose on the Upper North Shore. Glover had called in there in the early afternoon. Unable to get a pie order out of the catering staff, he left. On his way through the garden, he struck up a conversation with Mrs. Cleveland, who was sitting on a bench, reading. When she got up and walked toward the main building, Glover seized her from behind and forced her into a secluded side walkway, where he repeatedly slammed her head to the concrete before he removed her pantyhose and knotted them tightly around her neck. Glover then made off with $60 from her handbag. Unbelievably, no one connected this murder with the attack on Mrs. Mosley at the Wesley home only 6 months earlier. The task force still had no knowledge of the previous offence. If they had, they may have discovered that a portly middle-aged man with grey hair was in the vicinity on both occasions. There were no clues, and the seemingly invisible murderer vanished into the afternoon. Again, the task force was just baffled. Surely, fucking someone must have seen this come. They checked and cross-checked witness statements and canvassed retirement villages and joggers, cab and bus drivers and junk mail deliverers. They even sent a history of the case to the FBI in a vain hope of a leak. Sydney's lower North Shore was now under siege. People stayed off the streets, and anyone with elderly neighbours or relatives was checking on them at regular intervals. Old women were being driven to and from the shops. No one was taking chances. And still, police investigations continued. The checking and the cross-checking just carried on. What the police desperately needed was a break. Anything, just even a little one, would be enough. And then, a break at last. A week after the Olive Cleveland murder, the police got their first break as the agonisingly slow cross-checking actually paid off, and a pattern emerged. In several of the attacks, the victims recalled seeing a grey-haired, well-dressed, middle-aged man. Now, the very first victim, Mrs. Margaret Todhunter, recalled a man of that description passing her just before she was attacked from behind and robbed of her purse. And Mrs. Effie Carney, who was bashed and robbed of her groceries in August, also described her assailant as a well-built, mature man with grey hair. Both victims described their attacker as an average type of person. Police realised that they may have been looking for the wrong man. Their killer could well slip in and out of places unnoticed because he was simply not the noticeable type. Armed with this sense of what the granny killer possibly looked like, the police now still just had to find this average man. On the 23rd of November, another body turned up. The third for the month. While purchasing whiskey in Mosman, Glover spotted 92-year-old Muriel Falconer struggling down the street with a load of shopping. He returned to his car, collected his hammer and gloves, and followed her to her front door. As Mrs. Falconer was partially deaf and blind, she didn't actually notice Glover slip through the door behind her with his gloves on and his hammer raised. He silenced her by holding his hand over her mouth as he hit her repeatedly about the head and neck. As she fell to the floor, he started to remove Mrs. Falconer's pantyhose, but she regained consciousness and cried out. Glover struck her again and again. And only when he was satisfied that she was now completely unconscious did he remove her undergarments and strangle her to death. He was sure to close the front door for privacy. He then searched her purse and the rest of the house before he left quietly with $100, his hammer, and his gloves in a carry bag. It wouldn't be until the following afternoon, when a neighbour dropped by, that the body was discovered. Although the murder scene was chaotic, this was the first real chance the police had to obtain clues. This crime had been committed indoors, and nothing had been disturbed since. No little old ladies washing down the footpath, no students walking by, a clean, pristine crime scene. The police found a perfect footprint in blood on the carpet. Their first solid clue since the investigation had begun. However, Task Force leader Mike Hagen still needed to get lucky to apprehend this person who seemed to be able to just come and go as he pleased without appearing in any way out of place. The break came on January 11th, 1990, when Glover finally slipped up in a big way. But it would be a further 3 weeks before the incident reached the ears of the task force. On that fateful January day, Glover called at the Greenwich Hospital for an appointment with its administrator, Mr. Reg Cadman. Afterwards, Glover, dressed in his blue and white salesman's jacket and carrying a clipboard, walked into a hospital ward where 4 very old and very sick women lay in their beds. He approached Mrs. Daisy Roberts, who was suffering from advanced cancer, asking if she was losing any body heat. He then pulled up her nightie and began to prod her in what was described in reports as an indecent manner. Mrs. Roberts became alarmed and rang the buzzer beside her bed. A sister at the hospital, Pauline Davis, answered the call and found Glover in the ward. "Who the hell are you?" she called out. And when Glover ran from the ward, she chased him and took down the registration number of his car as he hurriedly drove off. Sister Davies called the police, and later that day, 2 young, uniformed policewomen from the local Chatswood police station arrived to investigate. The hospital staff was able to identify and name Glover, as he was well known and popular from previous visits on his pastry round. When the police returned a week later with a photo of John Glover, Sister Davis positively identified him, and Mrs. Roberts said that it looked, quote, most like him, end quote. At last, a breakthrough. But for some unaccountable reason, another 3 weeks were to pass before anyone thought to move this information to the Granny Killer Task Force. And then, the police would make another tragic mistake. Detectives from Chatswood Police Station confirmed Glover's name with his employers, and then they rang him at his home and asked him to drop in for a chat about the assault at 5 p.m. the following day. When Glover hadn't turned up by about 6 p.m, police called his home, where his wife told them that he had attempted suicide and was in Royal North Shore Hospital. Police went to the hospital, but Glover was too sick to be interviewed. Staff handed police a suicide note that included the words, "No more grannies." And still, it didn't register to the constables that the middle-aged, portly man with the grey hair who was recovering from attempted suicide after assaulting an elderly patient in a nursing home and wrote in his suicide note, "No more grannies, grannies," may be able to help them with their inquiries. The police returned to interview Glover on January 18th, and with his reluctant approval, they picked up a Polaroid photo of him to show to Sister Davies and Mrs. Roberts. After the positive identification, one of the officers told Davies and Roberts, "We know who it is. We know all about him." Incredibly, another 2 weeks would pass before the suicide note and the photo wound up on Mike Hagen's desk, the dude running the entire task force. As soon as Mike Hagen saw them, he knew he had his man. But proving it would be a different story. Head of the detectives in the task force, Detective Sergeant Dennis O'Toole, said, quote, "We still had no evidence. And if he said to us, 'I don't want to talk,' we couldn't have proved any of the murders." End quote. Still, the photo matched the many descriptions of the mysterious, grey-haired, average sort of guy. And in his job as a sales representative, Glover could have been at many, if not all, of the murder scenes. Detectives interviewed Glover. He denied anything to do with the alleged assault on the elderly woman at the nursing home. Police gave him the impression that they were satisfied and left him feeling confident that his luck had still held. But John Wayne Glover was now under constant around-the-clock surveillance. He had 6 detectives assigned to follow him and find out every conceivable thing about him. Even at this stage, the police didn't have a scrap of evidence that would stand up in court. But in their minds, there was no question that Glover was their man. So now Hagen had to make an agonizing choice. Go in now and let the granny killer know that they were onto him and take the odds of not finding any solid evidence that would hold up in court, or sit tight. Wait for him to stalk another old woman and possibly catch him in the act. Tragically, Hagen actually opted for the latter. And sadly, it was a decision that would cost another woman her life. The police didn't let Glover out of their sight. But Glover didn't put a foot wrong. He occasionally stopped to look at an old woman, but his behaviour was exemplary. On the 19th of March, Glover called in at the home of a lady friend, Joan Sinclair, at around 10 a.m. He spruced himself up in the rear vision mirror before he was let in at the front door. Police were watching everything. Observing police had no reason to believe that it was anything other than a social visit. Besides, the killer had only ever struck in the afternoon and only with elderly women. But still, they watched every corner of the house. At 1 p.m, there was no sign of Glover or any sign of life coming from in the house. The police surveillance teams were growing increasingly concerned. 5 p.m. All was still quiet. 6 p.m. Deciding that, you know, something had to be wrong, the surveillance teams got the okay from Hagen to go in. Detective Sergeant Miles O'Toole and Detectives Paul Mager and Paul Jacob noticed the pools of blood almost as soon as they crept in the door. With guns drawn, they tiptoed from room to room, covering each other but careful not to be caught in the crossfire should something go down. They saw a hammer lying in a pool of drying blood on the mat. As they peered further around the doorway, they saw a pair of woman's panties and a man's shirt covered in blood. And then, a woman's body came into view. Joan Sinclair's battered head was wrapped in a bundle of blood-soaked towels. She was naked from the waist down and her pantyhose were tied around her neck. Her genitals were damaged, but Glover would later deny sexually assaulting her. This was unmistakably the work of the granny killer. But where the fuck was he? Was he waiting in ambush? Detective Mayer almost breathed a sigh of relief as he found feet sticking out of the end of the bath. An unconscious, naked, grey-haired, chubby man was lying in the bathtub. one wrist was slashed and the air was heavy with the smell of alcohol and vomit. The relieved detectives prayed that he was still alive, and their prayers were answered. The man in the bath, of course, was John Wayne Glover, the granny killer. After he recovered in hospital, Glover told police of the final chapter in the granny killer murders. Glover had known Joan Sinclair for some time, and they were extremely fond of each other in a sort of platonic relationship. There was nothing sexual going on. However, after he entered the house on that March 19th day, Glover got his hammer out of his briefcase and bashed Mrs. Sinclair about the head with it. Glover then removed her pantyhose and strangled her with them and with others that he found in her bedroom. This sequence of events completely baffled the police. Murdering Mrs. Sinclair was in many ways out of character with the other murders and bashings. Glover rolled Mrs. Sinclair's body over on the mat, wrapped four towels around her massive head wound to stem the flow of blood, and then dragged her body across the room, leaving a trail of blood. When he was done, he ran a bath, washed down a handful of Valium with a bottle of Vat 69, and slashed his left wrist and lay in the tub to die. But he didn't die, and the police were glad of that. The police felt that if the suicide had been successful, then there would always be speculation as to whether Glover was the right man. Glover further brushed away their concerns by confessing to everything. Nonetheless, he frustrated police and psychiatrists alike with his inability or just unwillingness to set out the reasons for why he did what he did. The question why was repeatedly met with the same answer. I don't know. I just see these ladies and it seems to trigger something. I just have to be violent towards them. That was all he said. When he was charged with murdering six elderly women, his wife and their two daughters, both now in their late teens, were completely stunned. There had never been the slightest inclination that the man they loved as a husband and a father was the granny killer. At his trial in November 1991, John Wayne Glover pleaded not guilty to six counts of murder on the grounds of diminished responsibility. In other words, Glover claimed, like a lot of people do when they do something fucked up, that he was temporarily insane when he carried out the murders. The jury, luckily, did not agree, and it took them just 2.5 hours to find that Glover was both guilty and completely sane. Justice Wood sentenced Glover to 6 life terms of imprisonment and said, in part, quote, "The period since January 1989 has been one of intense and serious crime involving extreme violence inflicted on elderly women, accompanied by the theft or robbery of their property. On any view, the prisoner has shown himself to be an exceedingly dangerous person, and that the view was mirrored by the opinions of the psychiatrists who have given evidence at this trial. I have no alternative other than to impose the maximum available sentence, which means that the prisoner will be required to spend the remainder of his natural life in jail. It is inappropriate to express any date as to release on parole. Having regard to those life sentences, this is not a case where the prisoner may ever be released pursuant to the order of this court." End quote. Glover was imprisoned at Lithgow Prison, where he was held in a maximum security prison cell. In May of 2005, Glover collapsed in his cell and was placed on suicide watch after he told prison officers that, quote, "I've had enough. I want to kill myself," end quote. He was examined by a mental health review team and monitored by closed circuit television. He was also given medical examinations as a follow-up to the two cancer surgeries that he had undergone the year prior. And then, on the 10th of September 2005, Glover was found dead in his Lithgow maximum security prison cell and pronounced dead at 1:25 p.m. The 72-year-old serial killer was confirmed to have hanged himself. Glover was interviewed before he committed suicide in prison. He displayed two sort of personalities. When he speaks about the murders, his face changes, almost as if it's the voice of the other personality that he talks about. Quote, "One side of me was all right. The other side is dark, evil," end quote. In that other personality, the interviewer goes on, he folds his arms protectively in front of him, raises his chin bullishly, and for a few moments, it seems, you can see the face that he must have shown to his victims. Cold, arrogant. The face of an executioner.
When people hear about some psycho killer, it can lead them to thinking about the nature of evil, which leads to thoughts about right or wrong, bad or good.
All that thinking can get ugly.
Yeah, you don't want them considering crap like that. You just want them to go through the routine of living their lives.
And what do you do to gut their soul?
I was locked in an audience in the devil's maze. I sat by his room and we talked for days. He told me about his ancient battles with archangels. He told me loneliness was the torture most painful. We said if I failed, my lifetime was sent. I could end myself a seat that was right by him. If I didn't, that was fine by him. Cause every day a million souls just fly right in. He can barely keep up with the souls of all the people. It's not easy being sole controller of all evil. He said so many people wanna burn with me. I swear free will's a bitch and so's eternity. So what you learn from me? My savior from suffering. You don't wanna see the bowels of the earth rupturing. Take a breath, suck it in, I got more to tell. And time's of the consequence when you're in hell. When you're in hell. When you're in hell.
What do you do to gut their souls?
I don't do squat anymore. They do it all for you.
I'm not sure I'm following.
Mankind has progressed to a point that it's dim with its history, where life has been drained of all its enchantment.
I had a lot of questions. I asked the devil to explain. Why I always think that people have an infamy, and why I always feel like the sky's closing in on me. The skies are falling, it's just angels committing suicide. Cause it's so saddened by humans using genocide as a political tool. Considering no, you humans have the way you wipe a little as you want. Now hell is so full that we started expanding. Damnation is a business and the muckers are many. I asked him if a city street buckled and cracked, and hell rose to earth and would heaven collapse. I knew that smile was his response. So I thought to myself, he's almost gone. He's what, almost he wants. What he wants. He said, I'll tell you my one desire. That's for Earth itself to become my empire. Every politician's like a gun for hire. Even the Church of Nativity's come under fire. So you can tell I'm getting close to my goal of creating a world where I can torture every soul. Where sitting with the devil, this is what I learned. Apart from the ways a human soul can be burst out. Though we learn from our mistakes, we're condemned to make the same mistakes again and again. Sitting with the devil, this is what I learned. Apart from the ways a human soul can be burst out. Though we learn from our mistakes, we're condemned to make the same mistakes again and again. Again and again. Again and again. Again and again.